evidence-based, up-to-date. Where do we go? CDC. That's a big one. Because a lot of people will Google hepatitis vaccine, and then they're like, I saw this one child died from the hepatitis C vaccine. So you want to give them current evidence-based information. So the CDC and then the VIS are the big ones. Atraumatic vaccines, we talked a little bit about group two. What other ideas did you come up with?
You just kind of said what you said, but you also put a dollar or stuffed animal and show them, oh, this is what we're going to do, you know, like a
perfect
stuffings type of situation.
Awesome. So what age would be okay, Doc McStuffins, what age would be most appropriate for a doll?
Like 3, 2, 3.
Yeah, so like the 3 to 6
yeah.
age.
Yeah.
Okay, group 3. Which vaccines are combo vaccines? Okay, what's the benefit to giving a combo vaccine? You don't have to give them individually. Is there any sort of additional risk that you guys found? Correct. So that's your biggest risk. If they have an allergic reaction to like the MMR, you don't know which component they had that caused the reaction. Group 4, 2 month vaccines. What should they get?
Poliovirus, PCV 13.
For 2 months.
Yeah.
Okay. That's too many vaccines for my baby. What are you going to do?
You tell them that you can, like, space it out.
So they have the option to space out or refuse. And then what I like to do is follow up right away. So if they are going to space, I'll say, okay, you know, which ones did you want to give today? And then let's schedule your vaccine appointment. So then it's on the books that they're coming back just for vaccines. And usually that's just a nurse. Group 5, 5-year-olds starting school.
So they should get the IPV, MMR, and varicella, which are all sub-Q, and then the influenza and DTaP, which are IM.
Okay. And then any sort of vaccines that they missed or not up to date on. These are the 2016 CDC vaccine schedules. I put them there for you guys to check out. Has some different information on each of the pages. The vaccine, did you say it's hard?
No. From the exam.
So when you're studying for vaccines, a lot of people are like really confused about what to study for or where to study. Break your vaccines into sub-Q, IM, live. So who you would give a live vaccine to, who you wouldn't, who you would give those combo vaccines to, how you would educate, atraumatic holding. Other things that happen in the health supervision home are good oral health care. So in addition to giving vaccines and educating them, we're promoting, just in general, promoting general health. Healthy weight, healthy activity, good hygiene, and then safe stomach. This is considered, these promotions are considered primary prevention. So it's the first way we can prevent cavities. It's the first way we can prevent obesity. It's the first way we can prevent skin cancer. So a primary prevention for those. The RN has to collaborate with the patient and the family so that they can have optimal health. Is this important for just peds? So primary prevention for everybody. This is a goal of Healthy People 2020. I'm sure you guys have heard of it before. Chapter 32. I always think it's weird to me to lecture on doing a physical assessment on a child. I'll do the best that I can to explain things to you. A head to toe, like I said, is a head to toe. So your head to toe, the process in which you do your head to toe is all the same. Least invasive to more invasive. So you're going to start with listening first to them, so talking to them, getting their health history. With peds, really important to gather your materials. so that you're not leaving a baby in an open crib and then going to get your stethoscope. So get everything that you need and then approach. So I start my approach from the door and see how I kind of feel out the environment. How's the kid doing? How's the kid going to react to me? And then I base whether I'm going to talk to the kid first or mom first. You know, if it's a super afraid toddler, then I'll try to establish a relationship with mom and occasionally play with the kid. If it's a baby, then I try to bond with the baby or the teen first. Observe. I typically count my respirations while I'm standing, looking at them, because that's something I don't even have to touch them for. I can count. Complete health history, and then you're going to assess. So for your history, you want, especially with peds, we want to know their prenatal health. So if they're under two, we want to know, was mom exposed to anything? Were they preterm? Did they get their vaccines right away at birth? Do they need more vaccines? You want to know why they're there, where they live, who they live with, who lives at their house. Are there cats? Are there dogs? Are there siblings? Is it just mom and baby? Is it mom and dad and grandma and grandpa? So you kind of want to get who their support system is at that visit as well. Current system, so are they healthy? Are they not healthy? Are they coming in for just a well check? Are they coming in for something acute? So remember, our adults are problem focused. So if they're coming in for something acute and we need to give them some car seat education, what do we teach on first? The acute issue. So if they're coming in for a respiratory illness, we'll teach on a respiratory illness first and how to manage that, and then we'll talk about car seat safety if we need to. Therapeutic communication, so a lot of active listening, open-ended questions. Do you feel good? No, I don't feel good. That doesn't really get you anything. So I'll say, why are you here? Why are you at the doctor's office? Why are you at the hospital? To see what kids say to me. And then eliminate any barriers to communication. So oftentimes with teenagers, that means you need them to put their phone down, or sometimes you have to mute the TV or turn the TV off. So I'll say, do you want to talk to me while the TV's on? Or should we turn the TV off and talk for a few minutes and then come back to the TV? So if they're watching TV, they're not going to answer my questions. And then we want to make sure that they have a good medical home or a place that they go to get their care. Review of systems. So we're going to kind of go through everything. The growth and development, a lot of those screenings are going to be done already, right? Because you've had parents fill out whatever developmental screening they're using. The physician or you as the nurse are doing the other screening, and then you're going to assess everything else. So again, you're going to start with things that are least invasive to most invasive. So head and neck would be the outside of your head, the outside of your neck. That doesn't mean in your mouth. Mouth comes later, teeth come later. Because like I said, you want to start from least invasive to most invasive. So you're not going to exam somebody's scrotum before you've had a conversation with them. That would be odd. And you're not going to look at their teeth before you've talked to them to be sure that they can talk and open their mouth. So oftentimes I'll count respiratory rate, like I said, from where I'm standing if I can see, or I'll move around and try to count. I'll count while I'm talking to mom. So I'm sitting with mom and mom is sitting in the chair. I'm sitting and I can watch her, watch baby breathe. Oftentimes I'll do that while they're asleep. I try to do my assessment first while they're asleep and then vital signs after, because often the blood pressure or moving them for a temperature is going to wake them up. Apical pulse is easier to hear when they're quiet. So those of you in OB, it's really hard to hear right when you have that screaming baby and you're trying to count. You're like trying to get their pacifier in their mouth just to get them to be quiet. Where do we listen to the heart? The apex of the heart. For children younger than two, the apical pulse is usually around the third or fourth intercostal space. And around seven, it moves to the fourth or fifth. The other thing with kids is, so when we're listening to some of these systems, so we're listening to their stomach, we're listening to their lungs, you may have to stop. They're going to interrupt you. So it's not like with adults where you can just quick get your head to toe on. So you have to be confident before you ever go into the room that I can do a head to toe on anybody. I know how to do this. This isn't new to me. And then you could start, because you might get interrupted and then you may have to come back to a system. So you may have to come back and listen to their stomach, or you may have to listen to their back a little bit later. Toddlers often have that round belly. That's normal. We want to assess for skin breakdown, especially our diapered babies. So when we assess their urinary system, part of that is assessing to make sure that they don't have any skin breakdown in the diaper area. You learn to be very fast and very accurate with these kids. And most important to keep these kids safe all the time. So often at your pediatrician, they're on a table. So you can have mom or dad stay next to them, but you want to be sure that parents know that they're responsible then for keeping them safe. Again, first observe, then assess, then examine. Cuff placement for kids. This is just a page out of your book that I pulled out. Most importantly, you want to use the same cuff every time. So if you're using the blue cuff, which is the small adult cuff, you don't want to then use the bigger cuff, the dark blue cuff, or you don't want to use the tiny green cuff because you can't compare those then later. So if your blood pressure is high, then you want to make sure that it's filling up the correct space on the arm. Same thing for legs. Leg blood pressures are going to be a little bit higher than arms. So if you're doing it on the leg and previously it's been done on the arm and you're like, wow, this blood pressure is a lot different. Then you want to go back into the chart and check and maybe recheck where it was. It helps with trends if we stay consistent. Leaf can be classified lying down until they're about two. Important that we have a board called the standometer that we put on the board on the bed and that we hold their head and stretch their leg out. Oftentimes we're finding that who has kids and has seen them hold their kid down, put the pencil mark, and then stretch them out and put the pencil mark again, and then pick the kid up and weigh. My kid shrunk between visits, and I was like, well, and I kept telling the nurse, I don't think you got a good height on him. Like, he was really squirmy, and she's like, no, it's fine. And then the doctor was like, he actually decreased in height. And I'm like, no, he didn't. He's growing fine. But it was the way that they measured. We can start standing measurements after 24 months when the child can cooperate. Important that both heels are up against the wall and that they're not raising or don't have shoes on. And we want to make every effort to weigh the child completely naked. Toddlers can sit on the infant scale if they need to. Again, parents just need to be right there next to, or you need to be right there next to them. They can stand on the scale once they can fully cooperate. Best not to have mom get on the scale, mom get off the scale. Best not to do that, better to just weigh them individually if you can. And then pain scales are another, we'll continue to get into pain as we move forward. The flax scale is the faces, legs, arms, consolability, and cry scale. We use this with our developmentally delayed patients or the babies that aren't able to use the faces scale. We'll see the faces, the new faces scale. Your book is not correct with the faces scale that's in the book. And then the numeric scale. So the numeric scale is the numbers scale. How do we decide what scale is appropriate for who? Based on age and what else? And their developmentally, if they're appropriate or not appropriate. Again, stay consistent. So if you're using the number scale, it's best if you stay consistent. Sometimes kids have a hard time rating their pain. Bless you. This is my little babe. So how, again, is a pediatric assessment different from an adult? This is your physical assessment, not your psychosocial. It's not different, right? It's all the same. Do you guys need a break? Yes, no? Okay, take one if you need one. Like I said, we're recording, so I'll post later. Reasons for the majority of hospitalization. So this is broken down by age group. 5 and younger is respiratory. Why do you think that is? What's that? They like to put things in their mouth, hands, feet, marbles. They have a small airway, so narrow and what else? short. So narrow, short or airways lead to more respiratory infections for kids under age 5. Older kids, we see respiratory disease. We often see mental health problems, injuries, and then GI disorders. So vomiting. The injuries here are usually self-inflicted, so they jumped off something or they rolled off something or they hit someone with something. Adolescents, we're seeing problems related to pregnancy, childbearing, mental health, and then again injuries. So a lot of motor vehicle crashes in these older kids. If you think about it, think about the kids in your life, so nieces, nephews, cousins. You're taking them from their normal environment, their home, or their daycare, and then you're putting them in the hospital. Totally normal for kids to be confused, stressed, angry. It's normal for them to regress slightly to the age before. They're nervous. They have pulls. They have all these big lights. They have all these people coming in. Maybe they're in isolation, so you're wearing a gown or a mask. If they're in isolation, I usually stand at the door and I say, "Hi, I'm Sarah. I'm going to be your nurse. I just have to put my stuff on and I'll be right in." So that way that they can see that I have a face underneath all of this. And it helps people, it helps kids connect a lot better if they can see you before. We also have roller blinds at children, so I can stand outside their room and unroll their blinds. And I'll make faces to the little kids through the blinds so they can see me. And then it's funny, it's not so scary when you go in. Separation anxiety also happens. Factors influencing reactions to the hospital. So parenting styles sometimes change. Sometimes parents get really lax because they feel bad disciplining their sick kid. The child-family relationship often changes. You're changing the dynamics of the family. So if they're at home, typically with siblings, now we've changed that. They're getting one-on-one attention. Sometimes they really like that. Their general response to stress and attitudes about the care of a sick child. So if you think about it, I always tell students or new preceptees, don't be offended when parents snap at you. They're really stressed. They're off work. They're away from their other kids. They're away from their pets. They have things going on at home that they're not doing, laundry, cooking, whatever. And then we're putting them in the hospital, and they have almost no control. We're telling them what their kid can eat, where their kid can go, what they can do, what they have to take with them. So, yeah, you can take them in the wagon, but you have to take this pull, and you have to take these three tubes, and you have to take this wound back. That's a lot, if you think about it. I remember when my niece was in the NICU, and my brother was like, "I can't pull her. She's too many tubes and cords." And I was like, "Oh, yeah, you can." The nurse said we could hold her, and I scooped her right up, and my brother almost had a heart attack. His face turned completely white, and he was like, "What are you doing? Her number is her monitor." I'm like, "She's fine. You can hold her." And so he refused. And the nurses were like, "Is everything okay with him?" I'm like, "He's scared to death. This is his third kid, and now she's attached to all this. He's never been exposed to this before." And it seemed very normal to me, but she also wasn't my child. So you have to think about that parent-child relationship to the family relationship. It's going to change, and it's going to sometimes look different in the hospital. That doesn't mean they don't care. It may just mean that they're really frightened. So methods to promote coping. This is, again, atraumatic care in kids. Child teaching before events. So think back to your last chapter is how we taught those kids to deal with procedures or things that we were doing. Sometimes we'll do imagery, and, you know, tell them to close their eyes and imagine that they're somewhere else. Music, blowing bubbles, breathing techniques. How could we, in the adult hospital, what do you use for breathing? What do you set at the bedside and say, "Do this"? Okay. Do you think a three-year-old is going to do, you're going to say, "Here's your IS, please do this 10 times every hour when you see a commercial"? What is your three-year-old going to do to you? Okay, so what else can you do? How can you get them to do IS, if you will? You can make it a game. Is there anything else you could use besides your IS that you're so attached to? Bubbles. Bubbles are really common. You have to suck in order to blow forcefully out. What else do you have to do that with? What'd you say? Candles. We often use pinwheels in the hospital too. So we have a bucket of pinwheels in our bathroom. So if they can't do bubbles, our parents are like, "They're too messy." I'm like, "You don't have to clean the floor, just We'll send somebody to clean the floor for you. But pinwheels are a good one, too. So it's fun for them. So I'll tell mom or dad, like, you blow the pinwheel and then have them blow the pinwheel and see who can blow it faster, who can make it spin more times. Count how many times it spins. So you can make it a game. Count how many bubbles you can blow. Four phases of nursing care for the hospitalized child. Again, we're going to introduce, establish our trust. Any sort of decision making that needs to happen. You want to partner with your patient, but then your parents as well. And allow participation as much as possible. So if there's a choice that can be made, we want to weigh the pros and cons of both choices. As the nurse, if a parent says to you, what would you do? What are you going to say? We need to do IM or something because your child lost their IV. Do they have another choice? Restart the IV. So we can restart the IV, but they only need one more dose of Rocephin. So we can restart the IV and do the Rocephin IV, or we could do the IM Rocephin. What are the pros and cons to each? So those are things parents are going to ask you and you'll have to think about quickly on the spot. So the pros of starting the IV is that it's there. We can leave it there if they need it for another dose in the future. The pro for the shot is it's one shot. It goes in, it's done, and then they're not connected to anything. And they potentially don't need another dose. So you also want to make sure that you're checking their labs and, you know, you're thinking about the whole big picture of your patient before you present something to a family. What techniques can we use to reduce stress in kids? One of the questions I just looked at in one of the books was, how can you describe an otoscope to a child? And the options were, this is going to feel like a sharp pencil in your ear. Can say, this isn't going to hurt at all, it'll just be really fast. I see some nose shaking. Or you can say that this is something that goes into your ear, we're going to look and then we'll take it out. It might be uncomfortable for a second. What sounds best? The last one. A sharp pencil in my ear when I'm a toddler, what does that sound like you're going to do? Stab them, right? We sometimes play with the little kids too, like, let's see if we can see anything in your ears. So we'll say, oh, we saw the zoo in your ears, or we saw this, and kids think that's really funny. Steps for the admission process. Who's seen an admission in the hospital in an adult setting? Some of you have. So very much like that for kids as well. You're going to establish your relationship, introduce yourself. With kids, a smile goes a really long way. Letting the family know what's expected and what's coming. So I always explain to people too, you can pick her up, you can take her out of the room, or if they're in isolation, they're in isolation, but I can bring some toys in here, some Play-Doh or some coloring books. So I'd like to give them some choices and explain to them all the resources that we have. We want to talk to the kids in the level that's appropriate for them. Make sure they're oriented to the hospital because it's already fearful they're in the hospital with their kid. And then they have no idea where to get food and no idea where to get coffee, and they're stuck in their room. So now they're even more stressed. So if you can meet the needs of the parents at the same time, that's great. Why do we start discharge teaching at admission?
So they hear it over and over again.
It becomes second nature, right? So if I'm teaching you addressing change multiple times and we're talking about it, you're going to get more comfortable with it. Then if I say, okay, your kid has to go home with a dressing tomorrow, and I'm going to show you this one time how to do it. That can be really scary to people. Different types of admission we see. So the general inpatient admission, so the acute care, emergency and urgent care, as we see, you'll see a lot of kids in and out of there. Some people are using the emergency room and urgent care as their health supervision or their health home. Why do you think that is? Lack of insurance. What else? Availability. Maybe they're working and their office doesn't have hours outside of they work Monday through Friday, 8 to 5, and the office closes at 4. Pediatric intensive care. Outpatient and special procedures unit. So sometimes they'll go to radiology and get a drain or a PICC line placed in radiology. And and then rehab units or hospitals. The PICU oftentimes signifies for families death or long-term illness, so the PICU, saying your kid is going to the PICU can be really frightening for parents. Isolation rooms, so when kids are in isolation for MRSA or respiratory illness, a lot of times this time of year, the whole hospital is isolated because we're restricting people in and out of the hospital depending on when our flu season peaks and then drops off, so sometimes we restrict who comes. Children are experiencing sensory deprivation because they're used to being in their own environment and now they don't have any choice. Their primary job is to play, and they're stuck in this crib that my daughter says looks like a birdcage. So we toured the unit when I started working at Children's. She's like, why does this look like a birdcage? I'm like, well, it's to keep them safe and to keep them at the level where, you know, nurses can get to them. But that can be scary. So bringing in whatever you can for those kids. Isolation is often used when we're ruling out diseases. So we've drawn urine. Some of you guys did a workup on sepsis. So when you do a sepsis workup, you put them in isolation, and then you don't start antibiotics until we know for sure what they have to protect everyone else. We want family to visit when they can. Parents are encouraged to sleep over. And then again, allow kids to see your face before you put your mask on if it's possible. Therapeutic play is non-directed, so we're typically just letting them play. We have playrooms that they can go into. It focuses on helping kids cope, so when they're doing that music therapy or working with Child Life, it allows them to express their feelings. We'll do some supervised play with medical equipment. So sometimes we bring pumps in or drains, or we'll bring an IV catheter with tape and we'll tape it to a teddy bear. We'll cast animals. We'll let them experiment with different things too so that they can feel more comfortable with it as well. We can let the child act out or dramatize real life stressors. So if you see that something's stressing them out, how can you make it more less traumatic for them? Drawing is another aspect that we can use. With the community-based nurse, so that would be your clinic nurses, your school nurses, they're going to educate and communicate, so lots of education. Your community-based nurses here in Wisconsin are typically your home health nurses, your clinic nurses, those free health clinics. Urgent care is considered a community health nursing. And the medically fragile daycare. So sometimes they have special daycares for like Down syndrome kids or kids who have special needs as well. School nursing is focused on improving students' health and safety while they're in school. So school nurses are trying to minimize the health barriers. So they're not there to fix everything. They're just there to figure out how to take the distraction out. So if you have a diabetic child, how can we interrupt her day less? So we set up a plan with families. She should come to the office this time. We try not to call overhead and say, hey, Lily needs to come to the office, because then that's bringing attention to her. So we want the child to know their schedule when they can, or the teacher, so that the teacher can say, hey, you need to go get your blood sugar checked. So they're removing those barriers that are in the school so the kids can still learn and continue on like normal. School nurses believe that kids have the right to learn and the right to health care as well. So they should get good health care. They're kind of a liaison between the community and the acute care. What I found out, I just went to the PEDS nursing conference, is that many times kids are coming in and saying, I just got discharged from the hospital, here's my bag of medicine. And the nurses are like, what were you in the hospital for? How long were you there? Was your mom with you? Do you have your mom's phone number? Because she can't do anything with this bag of medicine. She doesn't know when it was last given and when it should be given. So there needs to be some communication with the family. So really good that parents with kids that have disorders, seizure disorders, those diabetic patients, any of the CP kids, that parents have a good relationship with the school nurse. Because if you come in with a bag of medicine, then what does the school nurse have to do? She has to stop what she's doing because she can't just leave these meds on the desk somewhere and figure it out later. So she has to call now. So she stops everything she does. their responsibility has changed because our community is changing. We're seeing more of these kids integrated into the classroom. So autistic kids are in the classroom. Diabetic kids don't have a special classroom. Many times the CP kids are, again, integrated in the classroom whenever they can be. It helps our community, so it helps our other kids understand that there are other things that go on besides learning at school. I mean, it helps those kids get used to being out in society, being around other kids their age. With home health care, their goal is to promote, restore, and maintain health. So they want to get kids back to where they were before they entered into their care. They are direct providers of care, so oftentimes very autonomous. So they're going in the community, they're doing care, they're calling later and reporting to someone or charting. They're many times the case managers as well, so they're figuring out, okay, I've been to the home, they don't have enough dressing supplies, now I have to call this company to get dressings delivered, or they don't have enough G-tube supplies. So it helps to have a good relationship with the home care nurse that's coming into your home, because A, they're coming into your home, so, you know, as nurses, we don't want to judge what we're going into. We want to realize that families are stressed out by having a home health nurse, and maybe some other things in their household have lacked because of that. Okay, so we have 15 minutes left.